Good morning to all of you. Actually, I must thank first of all to Sharan to organize this session and inviting our organization to conduct the story of Sri Lankan butterflies. I am presenting this as a member of the Fly Conservation Society. So we'll start. Actually, the content of this presentation involves the status of Sri Lankan butterflies, just a briefing. And
Himesh, sorry to interrupt, you can be a bit more louder. Maybe you can, okay. If you're using your perhaps speaker near to your phone, near to your mouth.
Is it right? Is it okay?
Yeah, now it's okay.
And now it's okay.
Okay. This is the content of the presentation. We'll briefly discuss about the status of Sri Lankan butterflies and their endemicity. Even though Sri Lanka is a small country, we have very diverse habitat. So we'll discuss about those diversity and where to look at those butterflies, because then every habitat contains different sort of
butterflies. Must your voice is low.
Now? How about now?
Yeah, now it's perfect. Maybe you have to come closer to the laptop and then talk.
Okay. We'll talk about the different habitats and where to look at our butterflies. And I am talking about something about the history of studies, because the way that we come throughout starts from about 17th century. So I'll brief on that thing. And finally, about our organization. Because at the moment, we are doing so many works throughout the organization, and it's better to know about those things. And we can share those things with other countries as well. Because in future, we may do work together. So we'll discuss all those things and our publications as well. Okay. Sri Lanka is an island nation. Actually, we have about 65,000 square kilometers of land. In that land, most of the area is contained by dry zone, and one third of the land is wet zone. So the thing is that we have a hill country, mountain zone in the middle of the country, not in the edge. So in the middle of the country, we have a mountain, and it gradually sloping down towards the coastal areas around the island. So that makes the weather pattern and rainfall pattern in Sri Lanka is very much unique. So in the western side, we get the wet zone, and in the eastern side, we get the dry zone. That's the main divisions of Sri Lanka. So in the dry zone, you can see the elephants in the picture. Actually, the dry zone is the land of large mammals. There are so many large mammals in the dry zone. So the dry zone has a very large carrying capacity. That area consists of thorny forest, and main food production comes from the dry zone of our country. And in the wet zone, it has very low carrying capacity because the soil fertility is very much low. But the thing is, the wet zone of Sri Lanka is unique in endemism, because that area is very much isolated from other areas. So the species had enough time to evolve as a distinct species in those areas. So the endemism is much more high in wet zone, but the species are not much bigger animals found in wet zone. They are very small animals, but the endemicity is very much high. So in the images you are seeing in the right hand side, those are the wet zone species, and all of them are endemic to Sri Lanka. So that's the basic thing about Sri Lanka. And other thing is that in the from the central mountains, there are so many rivers are starting. So the rivers flow throughout the country in a radial manner. And we have about 32 perennial rivers and about 100 seasonal rivers. So we get so many or so much of water during the
month of... are you talking using the same slide or able to see only the slide?
So in Sri Lanka we have so many water resources like those. So actually when we come to butterflies, we have 240 species of butterflies. Actually the number given here is quite wrong, about 28 endemics. Actually it's 31. We have 31 endemic species, 248 is the total number. Our largest butterfly is a Sri Lankan butterfly, just to know. That's an endemic butterfly. And the smallest one is grass jewel. Actually, it is also found even in India. So that's the variation within our butterfly population.
Himesh, sorry to interrupt. To all the participants, to all the 60 plus participants who have joined, this session is we are using just an basic account. So this session will stop in the next 10 minutes, if I'm right. So if it stops, please don't worry. Please rejoin using the same ID and password. We'll continue from there. Yeah, Himesh, you can go on.
Okay. These are the numbers of our butterflies. Actually, we have 15 species of Papilionidae species. The numbers given in parentheses are the endemic species. Actually, we have quite a few Papilionidae species. The endemic two are the Sri Lankan bird wing and Sri Lankan rose. And we have about 28 Pieridae species. As you know, this is the group that is mostly found during the migration. So the main component of our migration consists of this Pieridae family, especially the emigrants and albatrosses. So, and the Nymphalidae is a very big family. Actually, sometimes back this family split into several families, but now again it is lumped. So, Nymphalidae contains a very vast amount of variations within those butterflies. Especially when we take the subfamily Saturninae, that's the subfamily, that's the single group that we have most of the endemic butterfly species. That is because they are, that family is a very much sedentary family. So they doesn't prefer sunlight like other butterflies. So they doesn't go out from the forest. So they are very they are restricted to very limited area. So since they develop as endemic species. So the Saturninae subfamily is the subfamily that we have most of the endemic butterflies as a group. And we have so many Lysanidae butterfly species. Actually, it's about 86 species. When we compare to India, that is quite few. But the thing is, we have a range of species from silly lions, peacock royals, and lion blues. Likewise, we have a vast range of Lysanidae species. And the Rhyodinids, we have only one species. It is usually found in wet zone. sometimes spread up to the intermediate zone as well. I think that lower Himalayas have much more rhyodinites, but we have only one. And when you come to Hesperids, it counts up to 50, and we have quite a good number of endemic species and a vast range of variations from their sizes, colors, and all those things. And the thing is that our Hesperids, you can see most of our Hesperids in early in the morning and late in the evening, unlike other butterflies. So if you want to see many Hesperids, you have to look for them in that time, but not the usual time of other butterflies. So it totally... can you hear me?
Yeah, I can. We can hear you. You can go on.
Okay. So it counts up to 248. Actually, the most recent finding was Shiva sunbeam. Actually, it was there for a long time, but we didn't know. Very recently, we could able to identify it as a Shiva sunbeam. Until then, we thought that might be a seasonal variation of Indian sun, but that is not. We have read at the early stages as well. And among these 248 species, we have three exotic species. All the three came from, I think, from the ornamental plant industry. One is orange micrant and yellow palm dart. Both of them came to Sri Lanka about 2 decades ago. And the recent arrival is rounded palm red dye. It came to Sri Lanka about 4 or 5 years ago. So that are the introduced species. Actually, they now maintain their own populations. And the thing is that when rounded palm I came to Sri Lanka, it has bred very profusely, and there are so many individuals in those times. But the thing is that later on, especially the palm squirrels and common babblers join in controlling this pest, because this is actually pest because this butterfly larvae eats banana leaves. So the babblers and palm squirrels start to eat the larvae of this butterfly, and now the population is under control. So that's the numbers of our Sri Lankan butterfly. These are some of the endemic butterflies. Sri Lankan birdwing belongs to the family Papilionidae, and this family mostly the endemics are mostly confined to the wet zone, especially the Sri Lankan rose. It needs very needs very good forested areas, otherwise it can't survive. And the lesser albatross, this is one of the major component of our butterfly migration. And the Sri Lankan blue oak leaf, actually in India you have a very much similar butterfly to this. I don't know whether actually those two are different species. At the moment, we are considering as an endemic species to Sri Lanka. And when we come to other, when you come to the Saturnia group, they are very much sedentary. You can see most of Saturnia species are brown colored. So they are always in shady habitats. So due to that isolation, many of the Saturnia butterflies of Sri Lanka became endemic to our country. So there are tree browns, bush browns, and jewel forings. Likewise, there are so many endemic species in this group. And we have some endemics in Lycinidae family. This green silver line is a quite interesting one, because it's initially collected in late 19th century, and there were no records of that species again. But in around 2012, we could find this one again. And from that time onwards, again, we haven't seen this butterfly again. So it's a very unique butterfly, because its life history is also quite different from others, because this butterfly lays eggs on completely dead trees, because there are Cremotogaster ants on those tree trunks. So from our recent studies, we could be able to make butterfly zones for Sri Lanka. So this is the map given here. We have a wet zone, then intermediate zone, dry zone. In the middle, we have the hill country and the northern zone. So these are the basic butterfly zones in Sri Lanka, and we will discuss this further. And recently, we did a small adjustment to this map. When we look at the intermediate zone, that's the that lies between the dry and wet zone. Actually, we split off the eastern part of it as a separate section. Actually, the subsection of the intermediate zone, because that part has the most diversity of butterflies, because due to the hill country, that area is the confluent area of both the hill country and low country, as well as the wet zone and dry zone. So there are so many different types of microhabitats in that area. So we can see so many butterflies in that eastern intermediate zone. But when you look at the southern strip and the western strip, you can't see the elevation gradient. So at that area, you can see the different of the wet and dry phase. So in that area, we are not seeing much number of butterflies as in the eastern intermediate zone. So this is that splitting is not published yet. It will be published in recently publishing sixth National Review of the Sri Lankan Biodiversity. So now we'll talk about one by one. Before that, we'll discuss about how the zones are created. Actually, these butterfly zones mostly complies with the floral zones of Sri Lanka, because most of the butterflies use very distinct plants as their larval food plants. So when the plant is there, you can find the butterfly. So most of the times, the butterfly zones complies with our floral zones. And if we take the number from 248, there are about 80 to 90 species that can be called as generalist. So they can be found throughout the Sri Lanka, but others are restricted to one or two of these zones. So that's the thing we can see here. So here's the way that we found our zonation. The reason, actually, we get two monsoons per year, northeast monsoon and southwest monsoon. if you look at the map, you can see that the northeast monsoon brings the rain from a very small sea area, but southwest monsoon brings the rain from a very vast sea area. So southwest monsoon contains lot of rainwater than northeast monsoon. So you can see that so these two monsoons come into Sri Lanka, but the thing is we have the central mountains in the center of the country. So the central mountains split these two monsoons into two sections. Actually, the from the central mountains, southwest monsoon split into western side of the country. So the western side gets more rain from the southwest monsoon, but northeast monsoon brings rain to the eastern side of the country, but that rain is much more less than in the southwest monsoon. So that's how we get that we get our dry zone and wet zone. And this is the typical image of our wet zone forest. We have so many streams, and other thing is that we have very tall trees with very very covered up canopy, and this is the typical type of our Sri Lankan rainforest. Actually, our rainforests usually have five strata. Apart from the canopy, we have emergent layer, subcanopy layer, shrub layer, likewise. So within the forest, it is very much hard to find the sunlight. So in this type of forest, we can't see much butterflies in the forest unless you see an opening. In the openings, you can see so many butterflies. Otherwise, within the shady habitat, we can't see much species in these forests. But it doesn't mean that rainforest doesn't contain any butterflies. They are there, but we can't see. So this is the main places, main two types of micro conditions that our butterflies are living. Most of the butterflies prefer to live in the canopy, because canopy is the only place that gets sunlight. Otherwise, the forest opening. So many are living there here, and if we do canopy surveys, we may find perhaps some new species, because we know that there are certain species very occasionally come to the lower levels, but they usually in canopy, and they are much common there than we are seeing. And the other type of habitat is the underneath layer of the forest. Actually, most of the Saturninae species and Hesperids are living in this type of habitats, in a very shady, dark habitats. In the picture, you can see a bamboo species, no? Actually, this is an endemic bamboo called Ochlandra acidula. This is one of the main larval food plant of so many Saturnids and Hesperids. So this is another microhabitat specialized for that type of butterflies. And when we go to the hill country, we can see two types of microhabitats. One is the open grasslands, and other one is the forested area. Unlike the forest in the lowland wet zone, the forest of this area is very much stunted. Very very short trees we have, and a special thing regarding the butterflies is that unlike in the lowland wet zone, the prime time for butterflies is very much shorter than the lowland wet zone, because most of the year this area is covered by mist. So that's not a good condition for butterflies. So we can see butterflies, especially in first part of the year, from January to March or April. In the other period of the time, we very rarely see butterflies because due to the wind, heavy wind, as well as due to the mist. So other thing is that the hill country is the area that we have the least number of species, because it is not good condition for many of the butterflies. But the thing is, if you want to see the butterflies in the hill country, you have to go to that area, because otherwise you can't see any you can't see those butterflies in any other areas of the country. Especially we have endemic to this type of cloud forest, and other thing is that we have some butterflies related to European countries. So the butterflies that can live in quite cooler conditions. So you have to go to a hill country to see those things, even though the number of butterflies, number of species are very much lower than the wet zone. But if we consider the lowland wet zone, we can see the butterflies usually throughout the year, and quite a lot number. And most of the endemics can be found in that area. So especially one thing I have to tell that, especially in May and June, butterfly population in the lowland wet zone that we talked just a few minutes back, butterfly population get a certain reduction due to the heavy winds, because all the stages of the butterflies are damaged by heavy rains. So otherwise, other than that, lowland wet zone contains a stable population throughout the year. But here, we can see butterflies in first part of the year. And when we come to the intermediate zone, I talk about the eastern part of the intermediate zone. This is one of the specialty. It has a sudden steep slope, sudden drawback. You can see that from about 8.5 kilometers distance, you can see an elevation gradient of about 1,700 meters. So that's a huge gradient. So you can see so many butterflies within a very few distance. So this is one of the major component in the eastern intermediate zone. Actually, I have marked here the location called Haldum Mulla. It's a quite special location when regarding the, when we're talking about the history of Sri Lankan butterflies. This is a quite special place in studying of Sri Lankan butterflies. So actually, I'm telling that we'll talk about him. There's a person called Ormiston. He's a tea planter. His estate was at Haldum Mulla, and from there he studied a lot of butterfly migration from lowlands to the mountains across his tea estate. So he has recorded many such things. Actually, I saw you the blue oak leaf earlier. Actually, we at the present condition, we never see a migration of blue oak leaf, but in those days, Ormiston observed migration of oak leaf from these lowlands to the mountains. So this is a very special place in studying our Sri Lankan butterflies. And one major forest reserve of Sri Lanka in the intermediate zone is Knuckles Zone. It has very vast range of habitats. You can see in the background, you can see some mountains and grasslands, forest patches, and in the lowlands, you can see there are some paddy fields. So there are some villages over there. So in that, in certain that type of various habitats, you can see so many butterflies in this Knuckles conservation area. Actually, at the moment, we have recorded more than 180 species in that this area out of the 248. So that's a huge number. That's because due to there are various varying type of ecosystem within a very short range. And other special microhabitat of the intermediate zone is a savanna habitat. We call it this in locally as talava habitats. These savanna habitats contains is a grassland, but it has trees in ad hoc places. So that's like a park. So it's a very good place for birding as well, because we can see so many birds very much easily. So not only for the birds, this area is very good for butterflies. And this intermediate zone can contains the butterfly season from late November to June and July. So it's a very long period comparing to the hill country. So this is a very good area for seeing so many butterflies. But when we consider the endemicity is quite low considering the wet zone, but the number of butterflies and number of species are much more higher than the wet zone. And this is the dry zone. Vast majority of our country consists of this dry zone. And it has mainly these two type of components. One is the scrublands. This is actually mostly the disturbed forest areas. These scrublands is a very good habitat for sun-loving butterflies. So you can see so many butterflies in this area. And other thing is that forested area. This forested area provides larval food plants for so many butterflies. The trees that you can see are Dryopetes sepiara. So that's the main larval food plant of Sri Lankan lesser albatross. So this dry zone forest actually is the main component of main producer of the migration of lesser albatross. So unlike in the wet zone, in the dry zone you can see highly seasonal variations of the butterfly population. So when in late November, when we get rains, the population climbs up, and in late January and February, the population arrives from that boost up start to migrate. So in February, we can see a lot of albatrosses are flying throughout the country. And this is the other type of habitat in the wet zone, dry zone, the waterfronts, especially the reservoirs, man-made reservoirs, and the riparian habitats. Actually, these are the two refugees of butterflies at the dry spell in the dry zone. So most of the remaining butterflies tend to be clustered around these habitats in the dry spell, and when the rain season comes, they spread throughout the dry zone. And this is the northern zone. Actually, in northern zone, you can see many of the butterflies that can be seen in the dry zone. But the difference is, there are special butterflies that are not even found in the dry zone. You can see in this northern zone. Especially, they are related to the African and Arabian butterflies, because this area contains very harsh dry conditions. So these butterflies doesn't like to be in good condition environment. So they they are used to be in this type of habitats. And other thing is the butterfly season of this area is very much short. You can see most of the butterfly from November to January. But in other period of the time, you can very hardly see any butterflies. But in that season, you can see so many butterfly species. Now I'll come to the history of butterflies, of studies of butterflies. Actually, I found these things just last week. When I am looking for some plants, I found this. Actually, this is the collection of Paul Herman. He's a Dutch fellow, worked for East India Company in the 17th century. As a hobby, he collected so many plants from Sri Lanka. So this plant collection is the basis for the Flora Ceylonica published by Linnaeus, and then for his Species Plantarum. So I don't know actually that these the Linnaeus has described these butterflies also. I have to find it because I just found it last week. So this is the evidence of the collection of butterflies, first of evidence of collection of butterflies in Sri Lanka. So you can see a jay, a common jay, and a glassy type here. So there are quite a few butterflies in his, from his main collection was plants, but in that plant collection, he collected butterflies as well. And this is the some drawings of by Robert Templand. Actually, Robert Templand came to Sri Lanka as a military officer. He's a son of a great botanist. And in Sri Lanka, he made a lot of collections as well as so many drawings of Sri Lankan butterflies. So you can see there are some notes on the sides. Actually, those notes are made by Frederick Moore, because Frederick Moore is the main person who described the collections by Robert Templand. So these are his drawings. And apart from the Moore, Francis Walker also described collections by Robert Templand. Actually, you may know that Francis Walker is the brother of the well-known Arnott Walker. Arnott Walker collect so many plants in Sri Lanka, and his brother Francis did collect butterflies and describe them. And this is the drawing made by Marian North. Actually, she is from a very rich family, and she used to travel throughout the world by a ship. So when we visit Sri Lanka, when she visited Sri Lanka, she also came to the Peradeniya Botanical Garden. If you look at this drawing very carefully, you can see a man with a butterfly net. Actually, he was the director of the Peradeniya Botanic Garden at that time. He's the man called Thwaites. So even he's working on plants, his main hobby was collecting butterflies. So actually, Thwaites was the person who encouraged Moore to do a book on Sri Lankan butterflies. So he did so many collections as well. You can see that there's a building over there. Actually, that's his quarters at that time. Now, this building is the National Herbarium of Sri Lanka. Actually, now I am working there. So, is the Moore's book. Actually, it contains of three volumes. First volume is based on butterflies, and the other two he committed to moths. So there are so many drawings in that publication. So these drawings are made by Hermanis de Alvis. Actually, he was the draftsman in the Peradeniya Botanic Gardens. So here you can see so many connections with butterflies and plants throughout this history. And the special thing is that in the Moore's book, he studied on so many early stages of these butterflies, and Hermanis drew all those things in a very neat manner. And then in 20th century, these books came out. First thing is the book by the Ormiston. I talked about him earlier, which he studied butterflies from his tea estate. And in middle of the 20th century, Woodhouse did a good publication on Sri Lankan butterflies. Actually, Woodhouse was a surveyor, and finally he became the head of that government institution. So since his job, he could be able to travel throughout the country. So in those travels, he gathered so many information, new information of Sri Lankan butterflies, and those are included in this book. So so in the late 20th century, these are the books that we had when we starting our butterfly career. One is the John and Judy Banks book. It's a book consists of so many tiny drawings. So it is very hard to identify butterflies using that book, because the earlier publications were not available to us because they were so rare. And the main book that we started on butterflies is the Bernard de Abreras book. That book contains images of specimens of all the Sri Lankan butterflies, but the text is not much good for us, because it doesn't talk about any identification features of Sri Lankan species. But fortunately, in this book had so many specimens, so we could be able to start studying with this one. So from those things, this is the present condition. We have so many publications on Sri Lankan butterflies, and those are done by various authors, field guides, and so many textbooks. So at the moment, we have a lot of information on Sri Lankan butterflies, but still we have to do something on those things, butterflies. So actually, to make awareness among people, apart from the national butterfly, about 10 years back, the government introduced provincial butterflies as well. Our national butterfly is Sri Lankan birdwing. And apart from that, we have 9 provinces. So each and every province has provincial butterflies as their logo. So just to make awareness among people. And not all these are endemic species of Sri Lanka. When we considered the commonly availability as well, when we consider in the this selection, because people have to see these butterflies, otherwise not use of making a symbol. So these are the species that we are selected for provincial butterflies in Sri Lanka. Apart from that, Sri Lanka has published so many stamps on Sri Lankan butterflies in 2 clusters. These are some of them. So now I come to talk about our organization. Actually, we started this organization in 2013, just started with some enthusiasts. Actually, the special thing is that this organization doesn't only contain people who are working on butterflies. This team consists of various type of people, engineers, doctors, architects, photographers, lawyers, likewise. So this is a collective of people in vast amount of fields. So that's why we have so many capabilities of doing various things. Because those people are not looking at butterflies just like a botany, just like an entomologist. So they have very different kind of views on the butterflies, and they create different type of things on butterflies. And our main mission was to protect the biodiversity of the country based on butterflies and their relative moths. So that's the basic thing. So we are mainly working on butterflies and moths, but not only those things. We are going for other insects as well, also for other related fields. So these are some of our annual events. We annually conduct a butterfly and dragonfly race. So this is an annual thing. And the special thing is that we have to consider both butterflies and butterflies. Dragonflies together was that due to the current weather pattern, actually it is now we are not getting the rains at the correct time. So the current weather patterns can vary annually. So we can't rely on that weather pattern, because that weather pattern directly influence the number of butterflies. So when the butterflies are few, we can see some of dragonflies. So that's why we combine those two fields together, because number of all together, we can count a certain number of butterflies or dragonflies. So this is the basic concept of that one. This one, teams has to be registered in the in our society. And those teams will give a certain time period in a certain place to see and list out the species that they observe. And we'll then give prizes to the highest observers. So that's the basic concept. And usually we conduct field trips for members, usually members involved in these field trips, and we are going throughout the country to study butterflies. So that's increase the knowledge on butterflies in our team members. Apart from those things, we conduct workshops. Sometimes we conduct workshops on targeted people, especially to universities and schools likewise. So they are not regular events, but we are doing those things when we when the time permits, and we get registered those people and doing workshops for those people. And this is the one annual event again. We conduct programs on butterflies for small children. So we do several activities with those children, and each and every child will get a souvenir. Actually, you can see those souvenirs. All of these souvenirs are made by our volunteers. So they are not, we are not buying from somewhere and give it to them. All the things are made by our volunteers. And these are some school awareness programs. Usually we are doing a few school programs per year in various parts of the country. So our members are jointly participated in these awareness programs. And other thing is that we are provide our expertise on butterfly gardening. So this is a butterfly garden made in a school at Colombo. So likewise, we are advising on preparing of butterfly gardening, especially for the education purpose. And we are conducting monthly lectures to our members. That is mainly based on butterflies, but not only butterflies. We are talking other relevant subjects as well. So we are conducting these monthly lectures at Colombo. So every member can participate in these events. And we are preparing a newsletter on Sri Lankan butterflies. Actually, our events and all those things are enrolled in this publication. You can go to our website and see, download this publication and read. Actually, this publication contains both English and Sinhala languages. You can continue with English articles if you want. So actually, today we are releasing the latest issue. So you can log into our website and get that issue. So this is the website of our organization. If you go to this website, you can take all the information of the our activities and our publications, all those things. So have a visit on this website and you may find this is interesting. And our organization is also maintaining a website on Sri Lankan butterflies. The previous one is on our organization. This is complete on the Sri Lankan butterflies. So there are so many images of butterflies, especially the adult stage as well as the larval stage. And if you go to the page of a certain butterfly species, you can see so many details, especially the larval shoot plants.